Let's take a look at high-rise storm systems. When we say high-rise storm system, we're not really talking about storm systems like this, which certainly are high enough to be high-rise, but that's not what we're looking at. We expect that probably everyone of us knows something about the basics of rainwater. And we'll look at some high-rise concerns because there could be a couple of things that you might not have in a low-rise. It's important to know that there's been an increase in recent years of roof failures, and you can read the Aspie Research Foundation report for more information. This is of particular interest to areas subject to hurricanes. Of course, water is the biggest threat from hurricanes, not the winds. I'm sure everyone here knows that. You see in the picture a roof collapse, but although that's not the kind of building we're looking at, but you see it does happen. This is partially due to the increased frequency of wet microbursts that we've seen in recent years. A storm will come up really quickly, dump a lot of water in a very short period of time. We talk about 100-year rains, which should happen once every 100 years. My daughter, born 20 years ago, was during a 100-year event, and we've had at least half a dozen in our area in Chicago since then. I think it's probably more than that. So weather changes. We have statistics, but you know, it changes over time. Part of it could be related to what we call, might call climate change, and then other things are just normal. Normal things that happen, like El Nino comes back every so often. So we should remember that while there are existing standards for roof drains, they are not complete standards, and they're lacking in some regards, and we're seeing more roof failures. Is this related? You decide. Roof failures are not normally going to happen in high-rise structures. You would see that more probably in the stadium that we saw before, maybe a warehouse, something with a large area. But we'll see other issues such as extreme pipe movement and other scary phenomenon in high-rises, and some things need to be considered. You could see, if you like statistics, you could look at this graph, and it could give you some information on the stress, the way it can build, the inertial vertical stress or the initial vertical stress and the initial horizontal stress, and how they can be amplified. IPC requirement, to begin with, ASME A112.21.2 regulates the design and construction of roof drains, but the current standard only permits roof drains to be constructed of cast iron, red brass, or leaded nickel bronze. Probably getting rid of the lead as we speak. There are other materials, but they need to be approved on a case-by-case basis as an alternative method. You wouldn't want a plastic drain being blown off the roof and causing some damage or hurting a person. Development of standards for roof drains include general purpose, gutter and cornice drains, parapet and promenade or deck types, which convey rainwater from the roof area of the building structures. This standard covers definitions, nomenclature, outlet types and connections, the top size, dome or grate, free area, and also things like the materials and finishes, accessories, and the purpose of this standard is to supply plumbing code authorities and others, like design professionals, with the full knowledge of the minimum design and quality criteria for roof drains. It is not intended for use as a specification guide. And caution, illustrations included in the standard are intended only to describe and portray typical roof drain types and are not intended to restrict design or to be used for specification purposes. It may be a big problem, though, that flow performance of the roof drain is not covered in the standard. So we have the standards, the drains have to meet the standards, but nowhere in there do they talk about the actual flow performance. So something to consider, and this is important to know. Being a vertical structure, the rainwater is a little bit different. Since high-rise structures are very much vertical structures, we need to consider that the rainwater flowing down the face or side of a building may be far greater than the amount of water falling on the roof, depending on the height of a building. This is generally covered in your various codes. Victoria Falls, which I hope to visit in a few months. I can't wait to hit what they call the Devil's Pool. I hope we can make this happen, but I'm not sure. Anyway, this hopefully you will not have this type of effect coming off of your high rise, but sometimes you have to guide the architects to prevent these situations that can be created. Let's take a look at some buildings. Here's the Aon Center for an example. It is 11,136 feet high. The building floor plan is 194 foot square, and the building has the same footprint from the bottom of the building to the top. So the roof is the same size as the floor plates all the way down. We might say that it is very vertical, extremely vertical, you might say. A perfect example of what we're exploring right now. So what is the area of the roof? It's a pretty simple calculation, and you may have already done this in your head, but or I'd like to use a spreadsheet. This is the rational formula, but 194 foot square is 37,636 square feet. I like to use this little spreadsheet here. It's nice because it can give us several bits of information within seconds. Using the rational formula, we can see that it's roughly 0.86 acres, and with a rainfall rate of 4 inches per hour and a coefficient of the roof surface of, let's say, 80%, or 0.80, this gives us 2.76 cubic feet per second, which is about 1,241 GPM. I would just round it off to 1,240. That 0.94 is not going to make any difference for us. So this requires a 10-inch downspout. In some regions, it's called a rain leader or roof leader. But if we look at our rate here, our area, we see that we'd be looking at 10 inches. But let's look at the vertical parts of the building. 1,136 feet high by 194 foot wide is 224,384 square feet. If we take 50% of 220,000, that's 110,192 square feet, all of which piles up at the bottom of the building, and that's a lot of water. Most codes require 25% of the area for one side or 50% for two sides. Always check your local codes. It's likely that two sides will be exposed to the rain from the wind, right? That's why we look at two sides. It could be just one, but probably it's going to be two. Could it be four sides simultaneously? No way. If that happens, you must be right in the middle of a vortex, and that's not going to be good. So hopefully that's not going to happen. But consider this. We need to make sure that our system can handle the loads thrown at it under reasonable conditions and expectations. We do not want to overdesign like HVAC. Oh, I didn't say that out loud, did I? Just kidding. Some of my best friends are HVAC engineers. So we're off the charts here. So this requires a 15-inch downspout. And don't forget that we also have the roof load. This is just the side load, the vertical load. But wait, there's more. Another consideration is the exterior horizontal plaza at the base of the building. The plaza also requires drainage. If the plaza drainage system ties directly into the downspout or roof leader coming from the roof, the water from the plaza might not be able to get into the downspout because the pipe is already loaded to capacity with more head than we are getting from the plaza drain. This water's been coming down already, and it has 1,100 feet behind it. So that can create a problem. There's a chance that the plaza drainage is connecting to the downspout within close proximity to the hydraulic jump. Not only does this present more difficult challenge to get the plaza water into the pipe, but it also is likely that air can become trapped when you have a microburst. All of a sudden, water's coming down at a huge rate. So you could get a slug of water with some air trapped underneath it. Within the lower segments of the storm drainage system, you could have quite a bit of pneumatic pressure. But wait, there's more, as he would say. So the plaza also requires drainage. If the plaza drainage system ties directly into the vertical downspout, like we said, the water from the plaza may not be able to get into the downspout because the pipe is already loaded at capacity and it's got more head. So how is that water going to get in there? Excellent question. And this could be your result. When this happens, the air compresses, but the water doesn't. As we know, water's not compressible for our intents and purposes, and air is very compressible. So at some point, the air fights back. This can push water back out of the lower drains of the plaza or create a geyser effect. I have seen it happen. What is an engineer to do? Well, first of all, remember to be the engineer or an engineer, as I like to say. Make sure you take the plaza drains down one floor and downstream of the hydraulic jump and on the main storm piping. And we might also have to do something with the vent. So I've used this technique successfully and it works, but the code officials will probably be skeptical. They also have said things like, it's not in the code, so it is not allowed by the code. It may take some convincing and they may need some time to think about it, but hopefully you can get them over to your side because you need the vent. Explain it to them. It's not like you're connecting to the sanitary vent system. You're only providing a relief vent that allows air to move out of the way of the surge of water. And that can run outside of the building, maybe one floor up or something. And water should never come out of it. It's just going to be air, hopefully. If you plan it right, it should. But in reality, it's not really like your high-rise buildings are going to be able to have downspouts that go straight up from the roof down to the underground storm sewer. There are usually a few horizontal offsets throughout the building. Now, that's not always going to be the case, but quite often that happens. And I would expect that in most buildings, things, you're going to have some offsets. You need to be careful with the offsets, because these pipes are probably really big because it's a big building, and that means they're carrying a lot of water with a lot of momentum. And every time we transition from vertical to horizontal, we create a hydraulic jump zone, which is going to interfere with the movement of air, which will interfere with the movement of water. This causes some anomalies in the flow and also in the pressures within the piping. The piping needs to be secured and strapped to keep the fittings from flying apart under duress, but we don't want it to be too tight because it might break something, right? We have to have some flexibility in the system. We want the piping to be able to move enough to prevent the pressure from reaching a critical state, possibly leading to piping and or fitting failures. Now, we need to defer this to the installing contractors, but we need to take consideration of it, and also with structural. Plastic piping materials are especially susceptible to this pressure, and also from thermal expansion. The coefficient of thermal expansion can be a huge factor. If a plastic pipe from a roof drain is hung too tightly, the pipe can break from thermal expansion alone, right below the drain. So we don't want that to happen. I have included a lot of additional information for you to read and view, but there is always more available on the internet if you want to explore it further. Here's an example of some of my storm calculations. In this case, I was splitting, I have the area of the roof, and some, you might have some other roofs, more than just one main roof, you might have some others. And then I look at, if it's going down one downspout, what are my numbers? And then what if I split it two ways or three ways, etc. And then I also use the rational formula to look at the CFS and GPM. Well, we normally, as plumbing engineers, we're going to be looking for GPM. The civil and the municipal reviewers are going to be looking for CFS to see what effect we're having on the municipal sewers. And that's about it for storm. I'd also like to point out that you should look at siphonic roof drainage, but you can't use it in a high-rise building unless you just use it in the horizontal, and then you have to have a break somewhere, because you can only go about 32 feet vertical distance with siphonic. So you have to convert it. You could run siphonic across the roof, and then in the verticals you would have to convert it to a conventional, which means your pipes would get bigger again. There's lots of information out there, and ASPE is always offering seminars for this, and you can find lots of information. Thank you for your time. If you require any of these spreadsheets, please let me know and I'll post them. Thank you.